Today, we're going to be talking about different pieces of chemistry lab equipment. There's a lot of equipment that when we come back, you guys will get your hands on. Or if you take chemistry in the future, it is imperative that you know the names and the uses of these things. So we're going to spend a little time going through each piece. What you guys are going to need is you're going to need to have the worksheet. It was either in your packet that you guys printed because it's attached to your class, or maybe it was dropped off. If you haven't had a chance to get this packet, or it's also linked below this video, if you can print it now. I don't know if you're going to be able to draw all of these. I could not, but at least making sure you get down the name and the use. For the quiz on Friday, we'll make sure that we use these same pictures. Possibly for the test, we may take pictures of the actual equipment, but for the quiz on Friday, if you know these pictures and you know the name and the use, so maybe at least writing down the numbers and writing down the name and the use with it and then referring to the PDF, hopefully that could work. But the first unit is kind of hard to teach without a couple papers because we have a lot of equipment to go over. So what we're going to do first, and the way that I usually start this when we're in class, is I want you to take a minute. And I want you to pause the program and I want you to look over the piece of paper and I want you to see if you might surprise yourself. I want to see if you know the name and the use of any of these pieces of equipment already. So pause, doesn't have to be very long, but go through and see if you're in your mind, if you can't name and tell me what these are used for. All right, how'd you do? Here's a word bank of now all the names of the equipment that we have up here. Does that jog your memory and does that let you see a couple more? If you want to pause again, see if you can get a couple more, then now you have a word bank. All right. So what we're going to do now is we're going to officially take notes on all of these. All of these pieces of equipment are fair game for quizzes and tests coming up. I'm going to tell you the name of everything and then I'm going to write down the use. And I'm probably going to highlight a few things that you might want to remember for any upcoming assessments. All right, let's get started. So the first one we have here, they look a little bit like this. This is your apparatus you have. Please notice that they have a little bit of rubber on the ends. Try to get that in the picture. And then it does have a clamp here on the end, or place for your fingers on the end. These are what are called beaker tongs. So what you're going to want to do is break beaker tongs here. And what beaker tongs are for, which tongs, the same thing that you use in your kitchen. And beaker tongs are to hold hot beakers, whether you're removing them from a ring stand after you've been boiling water, things like that. So you hold hot beakers with beaker tongs. These are not to get confused with crucible tongs. The thing about crucible tongs is that they do not have any of the plastic coating on the outside. They look a little bit different. They have just a smaller opening than the beaker tongs without the rubber. So these are called crucible tongs. And what crucible tongs, they hold hot crucibles. So again, if you're taking a crucible off of the hot standard apparatus, you have a way to take it. The way that you remember to use crucible tongs is you always hook the little horns up, okay? And they also can be used as little pinchers if you need to pick things up. So what I would write for the use for these two things, beaker tongs and crucible tongs, they hold hot either crucibles or they hold hot beakers. I'm a big paraphraser when I take notes, so they hold hot items, whatever the name is. Let's see, the next thing we got here is called a burette clamp. A burette clamp. While you're doing the burette clamp, you might as well go ahead and write the part that goes with it, and that's called a burette. We will be using these in stoichiometry, hopefully in the second semester. And a burette, whoop, and a burette clamp is a little something like this. This clamp, okay, all I would say for the use of the burette clamp is that it holds the burette. And then the burette itself is like a very accurate graduated cylinder. So if you take a look at the burette here, it is a very long cylinder. Okay, and what you're going to do is you put liquid in the end here. And then there is a nozzle in which the liquid would fall out And then we would fill it up with liquid, and the liquid then would be measured. There's calibrations on the side. So you would, if you want 10 milliliters, you would then turn the nozzle, allow 10 milliliters to flow out, and then you would stop it. And so that is what a burette is. So what would I write for a burette? I would say measures precise volumes. The unit for volume is milliliters. We will get to that more here soon. But so it measures very, very precise. Like I said, we'll use this more when we're doing stoichiometry, titrations, things like that. So the clamp holds the burette, and the burette is used to measure very precise amounts of volume of liquids. What do we have next? Everybody's favorite for the next one. Hopefully you got this one right if you were guessing them. This one is called a Bunsen burner. Okay. And the Bunsen burner, we're going to learn how to light these next week. The Bunsen burner, hopefully it's a little classic look for when you think of chemistry, you might think of Bunsen burner. There is tubing. When we do come back, you want to make sure your tubing always has no holes in it. And then the different pieces and parts, we're going to learn about the Bunsen burner next week. The number one thing about a Bunsen burner is it's not to burn things, even though its name says so. We're going to say that the Bunsen burner is used to heat things. Okay. Bunsen burners are used for heating. We might need to heat dry chemicals. We might need to heat to boil things, liquids, things like that. So this is used for heating, Bunsen burner. Just a side note, it burns methane gas. This is a Bunsen burner. Just a side note, this burns methane gas that comes out of our gas valves around the room. So we'll talk more about Bunsen burners next week. What do we have next? Next we have, oh, again, a classic. This is called an Erlenmeyer flask. Sometimes people want to call it a beaker, things like that. You can tell by the concave shape, but again, this is an Erlenmeyer flask. I'll put it up here because it's hard to spell. Erlenmeyer flask. When you design something or when you discover something, you can name it after yourself. So maybe a bay flask, I don't know. But so we have the Erlenmeyer. The use for an Erlenmeyer is actually to mix things. So if you had a sample and then you had to mix a solid in it, or if you're doing a titration and you have to mix, the whole idea of why it has such a skinny neck is so that you can swirl and mix and shake things, and it's very good at mixing. So I love to put that one on any test or quiz assessment. So I would make sure that I write Erlenmeyer is for mixing. Awesome. The next one we have is called a clay triangle. And this is going to go along with something that we're going to have here very soon. The clay triangle looks like a triangle. Okay, and it has little clay parts that are broken on purpose. And what we can do with these is that they sit nicely on what's called a ring stand. And then we can take a crucible and we can put it on there, and then now it can be heated. So the clay triangle is used to hold this guy, who's called a crucible, and say crucible for heating. And now you're probably like, it's crucible and what? Well, the nice thing is sometimes we use metal crucibles that don't come with lids, and sometimes we need to retain some heat. So crucibles can come with lids. So crucible and lid. Crucible, it's like a teeny tiny little heating apparatus. Crucible. They come in ceramic persuasion, which is extremely breakable. We try to use those only when necessary. And then we have an iron one that, while it's rusted and doesn't look very nice, they're very durable. Crucibles are for heating dry solids. Just heating solids in general. Okay. When we do dehydrations, when we heat some metals, things like that, we will need to be using crucibles and with or without the lids, depending on the lab. Next, hopefully everybody got this one. We have two different kinds in this class. These are obviously funnels. I guess when you know that it's a funnel, And then defining what it does is a little bit funnels things, right? It funnels. So I would usually probably just write down it transports things or aids in the transfer of materials. So maybe helps transfer materials. And I say materials because most people are like, well, don't you mean liquids? And sometimes we do. And this one's the liquid funnel. It has a longer stem on it so that if you do put it down into an Erlenmeyer, you can transfer the liquid. But sometimes we would need to transfer powders. Powder funnel has the shorter little end on it, and it's a little bit wider, so you can put powders in it. So aids in the transfer of materials is what I would say. Perfect. Number 10, hopefully everybody has safety on the mind from yesterday's lecture. And number 10, we have our goggles. Okay, goggles here. Goggles are obviously to protect your eyes. We have a couple different persuasions of goggles. We have the goggles that we would need if we were using things like sodium hydroxide and things like that. They're the scuba goggle type. They're the ones that give you the nice, awesome lines around your face. So we'll use those when we need to. Other than that, we do have visor goggles in the class that look just like sunglasses. Okay. Awesome. The next one, there are actually two types here. I find the biology seems to use the eyedropper a little bit more. We don't necessarily call them eyedroppers here in chemistry. We use the plastic ones. Let me put some color in that. I might be able to see it better. Okay. And this is what this is called. This is called a pipette. A pipette. Even though I think the picture that you guys just saw, it looks to me like an eyedropper on there. But what I'm looking for is this. Is a pipette. And what a pipette does is it just transfers small amounts of liquid. There is no way to measure with this. We do not measure with, we only measure with certain things, but you can't be like, oh, it's a 2 eyedroppers full. We need to be more quantitative than that. So it moves, transfers small amounts of liquids. Transfer small volumes, if you will, of liquids. Next, we have a mortar and pestle. A lot of people are usually like, oh, I know what that is and I've seen it before, but I didn't know what it was called. So the mortar and the pestle, there are some labs. There's a lab coming to mind where we do need to crush aspirin before we use it. So what you do when you have a mortar and a pestle, you will just place the material in here and you will push, and people think you like Freddy Krueger it or something. No, you just push and you turn and you push and you turn and you push and you turn. And that's the way that you use a mortar and a pestle. So, oh, and I'm sorry, it is used to grind solids. Looks a little interesting. Let me find him. 13 is called a watch glass. I know it looks pretty, and maybe I'll take some pictures of these, but it's just a piece of glass, a watch glass. And it comes because it looks like the glass out of the front of a watch. They can be used as lids to cover up a beaker. But the number one reason that we use these is to hold a reaction. So hold. And I write reactions like that. They hold reactions. So like, for instance, when we do the synthesis of salt, we're going to put a little bit of sodium on here, pump it into a chlorine environment, put a little activation energy, and we'll synthesize salt right on the plate. So it holds reactions. Wonderful. 14, you probably were like, well, I don't even know what that picture is supposed to be of. 14 is just of a nice glass, and these are called stirring bar is something different. This one isn't too tough for the use. It stirs things. Okay, if we're trying to dissolve sugar or dissolve something in a solution here, you always have a stirring rod. They are glass, so you want to be very careful with them. When you put them down on a countertop, don't put them parallel. You always want to put it perpendicular because they do love to roll. So it is for stirring. That one's a tough one. Another thing that holds reactions, hopefully everybody knew what these were. This is called a test tube. A test tube. And the test tube, again, not for measuring. There are no incrementations on the test tube. That is not what we want to try to do. So I would try to trick you on a quiz and say, you know, do you use this to measure? And you'd be like, well, I eyeball. It's about half a test tube. No, not for measuring. All a test tube does is it holds reactions. So test tubes and watch glasses are just to hold any chemical reactions or liquids or anything that we have going on to keep it from going everywhere else. If you want to do it in a smaller vessel than a beaker. Holds reactions. 16, hopefully everybody knows what 16 is. It's a very smart cylinder. It is a graduated cylinder. I know I'm hilarious. it's called graduated because it's got graduations on the side. It has the markings. This is the only thing besides the burette that you will use to measure volume in this glass. So if I say, hey, go get 10 milliliters of sodium hydroxide, you are getting a graduated cylinder, okay, to measure liquid. So I also like to put this one on any test or assessment because often people kind of get tripped up. This measures volume of liquids. Does anybody know the unit for volume that we're going to use in this class? Milliliters. Okay, so again, if you're measuring anything, it's going to be in a graduated cylinder. And in your drawer, you're going to have 100 mil and a 10 mil persuasion. Number 17, probably wouldn't know what this is. We only use it a couple times. This is called an evaporating dish. An evaporating dish. You can probably tell what it does based on its name. If you have a solid, like if we have a hydrate or anything like that, you want to put the solid in there, put it over the Bunsen burner, and then remove any liquid from a solid. So it evaporates any liquids away. So you could say separates liquids from solids. So for instance, if you have some salt water and you want to boil away the water and keep the salt, an evaporating dish is your best friend. Number 18 is something I've been referring to, probably a little out of order here, but this is called a ring stand and a set of clamps. So ring stand and clamp. And let's just, while you're here, write holds for heating. We are going to go much further into this later in another unit or in another lecture, excuse me. But what we have the ring stand for here is we put the Bunsen burner on it, and then we put a piece of, this is coming up, I think, on the other page, a piece of wire gauze on here, and then the Bunsen burner is underneath it. And then so you can put a beaker on if you want to boil anything. So this ring stand portion holds things for heating. The clamp is here to make sure that the beaker doesn't get an attitude and jump off. And so the ring stand and clamp is support for heating or holds things for heating. Nice. All right, on to the back. Number 19 is what we were just talking about. Looks a little bit like this. It's actually called a wire gauze. I like to put wire gauze on things because people think that it just supports during heating, but it actually has a very important, use. So when the Bunsen burner, if we were to just take a Bunsen burner and put a beaker directly over it without any metal, the heat would be very concentrated right on the bottom of the glass. If you put a piece of metal between the Bunsen burner and the glass, it can diffuse the heat and make for a much more even heating surface. So I would say the wire gauze diffuses heat for even heating. I like that one. I like to put that one on the test. It's a good one with a good use. Next, we have some forceps. Forceps. Some people call them tweezers. I don't know. My professor in college always called them forceps, so that's kind of what stuck with me. Forceps are just for holding small solids that maybe you shouldn't be touching. So hold small solids. I think of forceps and pipettes to kind of be the same thing around here. One's to move liquids, one's to move solids if you don't use a spoon. Next we have here, where to go? This is called a wash bottle. Wash bottle. And this is for rinsing. People are like, woo, it's a chemistry squirt gun. Like, it's not, you're like, ah, no, it's not a hydration factor here. What it is if you needed to rinse something out, let's say we formed a precipitate in this Erlenmeyer and we're trying to get it all into a funnel or something like that. What you do is you can just use this and then rinse the inside of your glassware out. Because again, if I'm going to grade you on your lab and your data, you would want to make sure you get all of the, all your data out. So it's just for rinsing any materials out of glassware. All right, number 22 is something that we have here. Let me find that. Here we go. This guy's really small. You can already see what he does in the picture. What we're going to do is we just take this here. It is called, this is called a test tube holder. Test tube holder. And all that does is that holds hot test tubes. Holds hot test tubes. You can use it to pull a hot test tube out of a beaker, or you can use it to hold a test tube while heating. If you were then heating something up, and we talked about safety of this kind of stuff, but if you were heating something, you can hold it so you're not holding the glass. Test tube holder. The next one, hopefully you already got this. This is called a beaker. A beaker. Beaker. I like to put this one on any test, quiz, assessment, things like that, because the number one thing for the use that I get wrong for this is measuring. I almost wish that they would make these without incrementation on the side, because you cannot trust it because it's so wide. But so we never, never use beakers to measure. Okay. So a beaker is simply to hold reactions and liquids. Do not use to measure, holds reactions and liquids. Okay. Never going to use this incrementation. It's not very accurate. So this is just to hold any liquids that we have. The next one is where I'm getting the clamp word mixed up. This is called a utility clamp. A utility clamp. And what a utility clamp can do is it can clamp onto the standard apparatus. And it can hold anything cylindrical. So it can hold round things. Here, I'll turn this away and make this go forward. So what you can do, so we'll say utility clamp, excuse me, holds cylinders or heating. So you can take a test tube if you didn't want to hold it with the test tube holder and you wanted to heat something. You could put the test tube in here, clamp it down, and then now we're heating a test tube without having to get near the heat. You can also use it to hold a thermometer. If we were trying to take the temperature of some water, things like that. So it just holds round things, cylinders, for heating. All right, almost done here. Oh, I'm giving away answers. What the goodness. All right. Number 25. This is super simple. This is called a test tube rack. Test tube rack. Get this guy out of here. Very simply, test tube rack. There's a couple different versions that we have, but we have the nice long ones that fit nicely in our drawers. Holds test tubes. Number 26 is probably, if you understood what the picture is, it's a bad picture. If you understood what the picture is, you probably know what it is. Number 26 is a thermometer. Okay. The thermometer that you see in that picture, though, is an old round, an old-timey Celsius thermometer. We luckily don't use these anymore. When I first started teaching here, we did use these, and they're a bear to read. So we're not going to use those. We've upgraded ourselves to digital thermometers. What does the thermometer do? It measures temperature. And does anybody know what degrees or what unit for temperature we would want to use in this class? Good. We would want to use Celsius. We are not using Fahrenheit. So that's what we're looking for here. So we have digital ones, so it always tells you exactly the temperature and you know reading. The next thing is a test tube brush. It's my favorite. We put it on there because it's oh so important. After any lab, you want to make sure that you're cleaning up because you do share your drawer with other students. Test tube brush is a nice round cylindrical thing that can clean test tubes, but don't limit it to just cleaning test tubes. A test tube brush can clean a beaker. Okay. A test tube brush can clean a wash glass. Test tube brush can clean a funnel. Test tube brushes are amazingly, amazingly universal. So test tube brush is for cleaning. And last but not least, we have these two little items here. They're kind of hard to see, so I'll give you the names and then we'll zoom in here. One is called a scupula. A scupula is one that's long and just has like a little tray in it. And all it is for scooping up materials. And then one is called a spatula. We might use these when we are doing some dehydrations. If you have a lot of clumps, you got to break up some clumps of a solid. But they're to transfer small materials. We also just happen to use spoons a lot in our class. But so they are to transfer solids. All right. So want to make sure that you understand everything. The other thing at the bottom of the paper here that I guess I should just point out, these are the items that you will find in your lab drawer when you guys come. So what we would have done is we would have gone to our lab station, pulled all the equipment out, make sure that it was functional, make sure there was no cracks in the glasses, no holes in the tubing, make sure that you had everything. And we would have gone through all that. The last thing that I usually do here is I have a lovely little video of a young lady who is very confused on how to use some lab equipment. Clearly her chemistry teacher did not do her justice when she taught her how to do some chemistry. So let's get to that. All right. I learned about this video a few years ago at a conference and I just thought it was funny. So we'll end today with a little clip. I don't know how many Swifties we have out there, but Taylor missed a few days in her chemistry class, I think. So we got going on here a little scene. The thing about this is that we do have a bubbling beaker, but it's over a not lit Bunsen burner. Okay, so maybe some dry ice, maybe for effect, but there's no need to put it over a Bunsen burner that's not lit, but moving on. I could be just misseeing this, but she doesn't happen to have a solid in a graduated cylinder, does she? Because we know the graduated cylinders are to measure liquids. You're not going to put a solid in here and then try to pour it all out and not expect that it wouldn't get stuck. And you don't measure volume of a solid, you measure a mass. So you would need a scale for that, but maybe I'm seeing things. I don't know. No, that's definitely a solid in there. So we're going to mix our solid and our ominously red colored chemical liquid in a beaker here. It's already pretty full. That's okay. Let's see. Let's see how this goes for her. Oh my, you know what you want to do is you definitely want to have somebody come up and sneak up behind you when you're mixing chemicals. That's good. And definitely make sure that they don't have their goggles on, because you really got to protect that part of your head. You know, these eyes, no, right here. And then especially I enjoy that Taylor has herself completely turned around. Why pay attention to the reaction that you're doing? That's neither here nor there. So let's see what's going to happen. Who could have guessed? Whoa, I know that now they're probably going to go and run and tell their teacher, and they're going to wash their hands multiple times and make sure the teacher helps them clean up whatever chemical spill that is. Nope, just a bunch of paper towels. Okay, that's good. That's safe. No goggles, and goggles on her forehead now. Not quite sure. As she's cleaning up a spill, she decides to just take those on off. She's a great singer, but maybe not so great at chemistry.